Hi, and welcome to your technique video for the Milk and Interesting Mixture Lab. Let's go over some safety rules before we get started. I know I've said it a million times, but you need to wear your goggles any time that chemicals are out. You will be using hot plates during several parts of the lab today. You want to try to use the lowest temperature setting possible. It can be dangerous if you let some of the solutions go to a rolling boil. Make sure you don't put your face above any heated solutions. Remember that hot glass looks the same as cold glass, so use caution whenever you go to touch something. We don't want anyone to get burned. Check all your glassware carefully for cracks. This lab is a little longer and more involved than some of the previous ones, so it will be especially crucial to plan out the tasks and divide up the work to finish on time. We're going to use this graphic as we go through the procedure to help you visualize the workflow. So first, we need to actually get our milk. Determine the mass of the empty beaker and record it in your notebook. Take the beaker off of the balance and pour in about 50 milliliters of milk into the beaker and record the mass of both. It should be about 50 grams. Don't stress out about it being exactly 50 milliliters, just aim for roughly 50. You will complete all exercises in this lab with this one sample of milk. You should also determine the mass of a 250 milliliter beaker and two wash glasses. Then set them aside for later. Keep track of which is which. It may be helpful to use two different size wash glasses. Move to the hood and add 1 milliliter of 8 molar acetic acid to the beaker. Make sure you pour the acid into a separate container before touching it with the pipette. You and other groups can share this container. You will need about 2 pipettefuls. Place it on the hot plate. It should be set at about 3, but if it seems like it's not hot enough, you can turn it up slowly. Stir the mixture until the protein and fat precipitate. This may take a while. Another member of the group should prepare an ice bath by packing a large beaker with ice and pouring some water into it. When the precipitate is formed, place the beaker into the ice bath. If you fail to check your glassware for cracks, this is where you're going to be in trouble. Damaged glassware will shatter easily when it goes from being very hot to very cold. Let this cool undisturbed for about 10 minutes. Fold a piece of cheesecloth several times and place it over the beaker. Pour the mixture through the cheesecloth to separate the liquid from the solid protein and fat. You can use the stir rod to encourage more of the liquid to go through. Try to get everything out of the beaker. Then you can gently press the remaining liquid out of the cheesecloth. Get another beaker and place the protein and fat into it. Aim to get as much off the cheesecloth and into the beaker as you can. At this point, exercise 1 is complete. Your group should now split up to do exercises 2 and 3. The half doing exercise 2 should take the solid protein and fat, and the other half will work with the liquid that was squeezed out of the cheesecloth. The exercise 2 group should head to the hood and add about 35 milliliters of acetone. Break up the chunks as much as possible to expose more surface area to the solvent. Place the beaker on the hot plate. Turn it to low heat, around 2 or 3, and stir quickly to prevent bumping, which could cause the solution to splash out of the beaker and potentially burn someone. Once the solution comes to a boil, you should take it off of the hot plate using a paper towel, not your bare hands. It'll be hot, and let it cool for 2 minutes. Then put it back on the hot plate and let it come to a boil again. You should repeat this for a total of 3 cycles of boiling and cooling. Some of the acetone will evaporate while you do this. So periodically add more to keep it at its original volume. The fat should now be dissolved. You will now use a Buchner funnel to filter the solid protein from the liquid. You will need a sidearm flask with rubber tubing, both pieces of the Buchner funnel, filter paper, and a wash bottle. We will show you the general procedure for using the Buchner funnel. In your lab manual, there are a few additional instructions which you should follow. First, we clamp the sidearm flask. The arm should go on the side with the 2 prongs. Plug the rubber tubing into the vacuum. Snap the 2 pieces of the Buchner funnel together and place it in the mouth of the sidearm flask. Place a piece of filter paper in the funnel and wet it with some of the solvent that is in the filtrate, in this case, acetone. Turn the vacuum on. Slowly decant as much of the liquid off before the solid starts going in, because the filtration will slow down once the solid is there. When the solid starts flowing in, swirl the beaker and quickly empty it into the funnel to get as much solid as possible out of the beaker. Perform the washes indicated in the manual. You may need more than what is listed to fully wash away any impurities and to get all the solid out of the beaker and off of the stir rod. You should add the wash to the beaker that had the solid in it, then pour it in with the vacuum turned off. Tap the side of the funnel a couple of times, and then turn the vacuum on. Make sure that you do not allow the filtrate to boil. It can boil even though it's not hot. The solvent gases can damage the house vacuum if you let them go through the tubing. After you've completed your washes, allow air to keep passing through until the protein is dry and can be easily removed. Turn the vacuum off. Snap off the top part of the funnel and flip out the solid onto a watch glass. Peel off the filter paper. Remove the flask from the clamps. Use caution during this part because the rubber tubing can easily tip the flask over. When you pour the filtrate into the beaker, pour away from the sidearm so that the liquid does not go into the sidearm or the tubing. You want all of the filtrate to end up in your beaker. Okay, so now let's check in with the other half of the group that is working on exercise 3. Remember, they are using the liquid filtrate that you got from exercise 1, not the filtrate that we just showed you from exercise 2. Get some litmus paper and tear it into small pieces. The solution is currently acidic, which you can confirm by placing a drop of it on litmus paper. The paper will remain red. We want to turn it basic by adding a small portion, about 7 milliliters, of sodium hydroxide, a strong base. Test the pH again to ensure that it has become basic and turns the litmus paper blue. You may have to add more sodium hydroxide if it is still basic. Add a 1 milliliter portion of sodium hydroxide and retest. Keep doing this until you get blue litmus paper. Add 10 milliliters of calcium nitrate and move to the hot plate. Heat it on a medium setting while stirring until the volume has been reduced by about 1/3. This will take about 15 minutes. Then place the solution in an ice bath and let it cool undisturbed for about 5 minutes. You should see a precipitate. Use the Buchner funnel again to filter out the calcium phosphate precipitate. Once the solid is dry enough to be easily removed, empty it onto a watch glass. Pour the filtrate, which contains the lactose, into a beaker and get ready to perform the Benedict's test. You'll need a boiling water bath, so go ahead and start heating a beaker of water on the hot plate at the beginning of the lab period so that it will be boiling by the time you're ready to use it. Take 2 test tubes and add about 5 milliliters of Benedict's solution to each. One of the test tubes will act as a positive control. We will add 8 drops of a prepared 1% glucose solution to this tube. This tube will give a positive result that you can reference. Add 8 drops of your filtrate to the other test tube. In this video, we simply added water to the other test tube to show you what a negative result looks like. Place the 2 tubes in the boiling water bath and observe the color changes. The formation of a rust-colored precipitate indicates the presence of an aldehydic sugar. Take the watch glass containing the protein, the watch glass with the calcium phosphate, and the beaker with the acetone fat solution, and place them on a shelf or in a drawer that your TA assigns to you. You can write on a paper towel to label which is which, and make sure you put your names and the lab section on the paper towel so that you can find them next week. Next week, before you start that lab, you should determine the mass of the beaker and the 2 watch glasses with the various components on them, and then compare these masses to the ones that you measured while empty before starting last week. Hopefully that at least makes the procedure a little bit clearer for you. Make sure you use your TAs as a resource if you do not understand the concepts behind what you are doing. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys next week.